folks, John here with Through My Lens, and today I'm coming to you with another knife-related video. Today we're going to be looking at the Shirogorov Hation Zero. Now, I did an unboxing on this knife just a few days ago. If you check out the video that was before this one in my playlist, you will see that. I recommend you go check it out before you watch this video, as it has my first impressions of this knife, and it does have some interesting and information that does dovetail into this review. As I mentioned in that unboxing, I really do have a bias toward American-made knives. Most of my collection at this point is comprised of some of the best American knife makers of production and mid-take knives that are known. I've been aware of Shirogorov for a long time. I've kind of admired them from afar. I'll be honest again, you know, full disclosure of my biases, the Russian thing did kind of put me off a little bit. Not because I think there's anything bad with Russia, it's just, you know, I've been wanting to really buy American when it comes to knives because, for better or for worse, I think that's kind of something that's, I guess I'll say, uniquely American in identity, both knives and guns. And I recognize some of the inherent flaws with that thinking, but that's just, you know, my personal feelings. So why did I get this Hation Zero then? As a knife reviewer, as a knife enthusiast, the Shirogorov brand does have a mystique about it. It does have a reputation that puts it on par with some of the best made knives in the world. So that's pretty compelling, you know, at least to be able to want to experience at least once. I wasn't sure when I bought this, you know, if this was going to stay in my collection or not. But again, the reputation of the Shirogorov brand and everything that Shirogorov has been able to accomplish, again, very compelling. Aesthetics also had a large part of my wanting to pick one of these Hation Zeros up. Absolutely love these carbon fiber scales, and I've really not seen too many Shirogorov knives with carbon fiber that I didn't like, whether it, you know, being a different color or, you know, other different variations. I just really like how they do carbon fiber, and I think this is absolutely gorgeous. That's probably one of the biggest things to put in the plus column for this knife are the aesthetics. I think it is absolutely gorgeous. Very simple, but very classy, very elegant. Just, you know, hits all the right buttons for me. Also, the, you know, from a specs standpoint, this is a very compelling package as well. You're talking about the weight, you know, only about 2.5 ounces, and a blade length that is nearly 3.5 inches in length. It's I think about 3.37, just under 3.34. So a lot of capability in that blade. Again, that Shirogorov finish, also a big plus in why I like this knife. That finish is just amazing. Just love the consistency. Love the grind. It's an M390. That's probably my favorite blade steel. You know, it has been for quite some time. Very, very slender knife. Between the handle scales, this one very well executed. Very nice, very well centered. The lockup is early, as you can see. So no complaints with the fit and finish of this knife. Really, it's on par with anything else in my collection, and that's saying a lot with some of the brands that I have, Hinderer, Koenig, Reeve. Very, very, very impressive in its execution. A lot of people have called this the ideal EDC knife, and for many, that may be true. Probably not for me. I think this is probably one of the best dress EDC knives that I have run across. A knife that can be used when I wear a suit or I wear dress slacks and I just can't work with a bulge in my pocket or a lot of weight in my pocket. In a suit, sometimes even 4 ounces in terms of a knife can be a challenge. So this is very welcome in that respect. Is it as capable or as, in terms of my preferences, is it as good as, we'll say, the Sebenza? No, I don't think it is. Again, I tend to prefer a larger knife for most EDC tasks, up to and including the potential of using one in a defensive scenario. And I know that's not something that's not a consideration that a lot of people have, but it is one that I have. And while I think if you were pressed into a situation where you had to use this knife defensively, could you do it? Yes, you could. Certainly a lot less ideal than other choices that I have in my collection. Same with most EDC tasks. I think you've got enough blade there to probably get you through 80-90% of what you would need to do on a daily basis. I just think, a little extra size is just brings, I like the additional capability. I like the ergonomics of a larger handle. And for, again, 80% of my EDC, I can certainly tolerate and do prefer a bigger knife. Here's the one that I recently called the best EDC knife in my collection. That's the Hinderer Skinny XM18 Sheep's Foot. And, again, comparing these two knives, you can just see how much that the XM18 just dwarfs this Shirogorov Hation Zero. I really wasn't sure whether or not I would like this knife because of it being less than 3.5 inches in length. And as you can see, it's if you try to line up the blades pretty well, you don't lose a whole lot in length. You do. It's a little bit shorter. It's also quite a bit less wide. So it's undoubtedly, just smaller in all dimensions. But it's amazingly capable, in this package. What about the action? That Shirogorov action is legendary. A lot of collectors consider this to have one of, if not the best actions in the world, with that multi-bearing, multi-row bearing system that they use in this particular knife and in many of their knives. It's impressive. A couple of nitpicks. The flipper tab is a little pokey in my finger. The detent is on the stronger side. So it really does have an action that is fairly similar to, kind of reminds me of my Koenig Aris. Very, very similar in execution in terms of, they both have a stronger detent and the blades on both of these just kind of rocket right out of there. So, They're very similar. I don't know that I would say one is better than the other. You can see that this one will pretty much fall shut. This one definitely falls shut. I definitely think that the Koenig Arias flipper tab is going to be more comfortable than the flipper tab on this Shirogorov. But it's not horrible. Well, one of the problems that kind of dovetails into how the diminutive size and how this kind of can poke into you is the fact that if you don't grab or hold the Hation Zero just right, not putting any pressure on that lock bar, it's going to be more difficult to flip. I actually find it easier to flip left-handed because you're more inclined to stay off the lock bar. So I would probably give the nod to the Koenig Arias personally. Just comparing these two knives, it's kind of an apples and oranges comparison given the size differential. But man, that Koenig Arias is just amazing. Really is. Just love that. Oops. Let's try that again. There we go. But it certainly does have a very, very impressive action that I do like a lot. Probably the biggest negative that I have with this Shirogorov Hation Zero, and I think this is a fairly common issue in the Shirogorov line, is that one, this proprietary hardware doesn't use any Torx. It's not a big deal. You can use a number of different things on the pivot slot here to avoid marring it or scratching it. Some people use pennies, some people use polymer slots to fit in there. It's just something that won't scratch up. Because this screw is so much smaller, you've got much fewer choices. You almost have to use a very, very tiny flathead on that and just try to be as steady as possible to avoid scratching it. The proprietary hardware is a bit of an issue. What's bigger of an issue is that the backside of the pivot is free-floating. So, and as you can see, there's no good way to support that other than, maybe using some kind of rubber or silicone, to press as hard as you can against that backside. I actually attempted to take this apart to clean it and lubricate it, and I really wasn't able to get the pivot head off. I'm going to, make a second attempt down the road to try to remove it. I do prefer a knife that is a little easier to work on, to get apart, particularly one that I'm going to be carrying EDC. If I did consider this, a 80 or 90% solution for my EDC, and it was going to be carried most days, it's going to pick up a lot of pocket lint in my pockets. It's going to pick up a lot of dirt from being in my pockets. I just know that from years of carrying a pocket knife. Eventually that's going to collect in the pivot, and you're going to see, a deterioration of the smoothness and the speed of the deployment of that blade. Not an issue at this point, thank goodness. For me, a knife that you really are going to EDC, you've got to be able to take it apart reasonably easily, reasonably quickly, and get it back together. I kind of am not looking forward to dealing with that multi-row bearing system because it's not a captured system, and those ball bearings, I'm a little bit nervous about losing one of them when I try to open this up down the road. So again, the entire design is just not well suited, in my opinion, for ease of disassembly and maintenance. I'm not sure that that multi-row bearing system provides a whole lot of advantage over just a straight captured single-row or two-row bearing system like what you might find, again, in the Konigaris. I think this is every bit as much, if not more so, in terms of smoothness than the Shirogorov here. Man, that's nice. Really, really nice. So I would, even if it were, a minor detriment to the smoothness or the deployment action, I would prefer a captured bearing system. But that's just me. That's, just my personal preference. I recognize that a lot of people who do buy this will, never take it apart or find it necessary to lubricate it. And that's fine too. The other kind of negative, there's a couple more negatives. One of the reasons I stick to the manufacturers that I have in my collection, Hinderer, CRK, and Koenig, is the excellent customer service and the spa services that you can get from those knives. If you use your knives and you get them scratched up, or you get mar the finish, or you need sharpening help from them. Particularly Koenig and Chris Reeve really do have wonderful customer service in that regard. This guy, I do have the warranty card, which means I can send it to Recon One if I need service to send it back to Russia. Obviously that's going to take a lot of time. I'm probably not going to be dealing directly with Shirogorov in that regard. So communication, could potentially be an issue. It's just not an ideal solution. So for me, the value of this knife, does take some hits on that basis. The price too is a considerable issue. This is one of the less expensive Shirogorovs that you can purchase. It retails $700 if you purchase it from either Recon One or Knife Center, who are the two authorized sources that you can purchase if you want to get one of those warranty cards. Again, that's something I talked about in my unboxing. But you're going to pay tax from either one of those, so you're looking at nearly $800 to buy this knife. That is just a whole lot of money for this knife. At the retail level, that's more than what I paid for my Konigaris, which was certainly a ridiculous price for a much bigger, much more capable knife. What I will say in terms of the price is that Shirogorov knives has kind of entered into a phase or a period here that it is not hard to find many of their models on the secondary market and at a reduced price from retail. You can pretty much find this knife all day long on the secondary for between $500 and $600. And I did purchase this on the secondary. I did not purchase this brand new. Got a really great deal on it. You might notice in the unboxing, like there was some gook in the pivot here. It was dirty. I did have to take a Q-tip and clean, as best as I could without being able to disassemble it. Got a heck of a deal on it. And at the price that I paid for it, I'm comfortable with it. That puts it more in line with some of the other knives in my collection, like, this one, that's retail $550. this one that's, you know, retail for $425. It was, you know, more in line with you know, that price point. And I think at that price point, it is again very, very compelling. This one, as you can see, is just immaculate. It looks brand new, particularly after I've done a little bit to clean it up. So the blade is completely unused. So the deals are out there if you do want to pick these up, which is good. That's I'll compare that to like a Holt Blade Works that, you know, again, at this juncture, their, you know, demand is far, far outstripping supply for either the Spectre or the newer model that Holt has introduced, the Haptic. And, you know, it may be another 5 years or more before you're able to find reasonably priced or even table priced offerings from Holt Blade Works on the secondary market. You're certainly not going to do that now. And when that happens, you know, I'm patient. I'll wait because I'm not going to pay $1,500 or $2,000 for one of those knives. And it wasn't so long ago that many Shirogorovs were commanding really, really high prices on the secondary market. But again, given enough time, supply and demand will even out, and you'll be able to pick up any knife, you know, at or below retail on the secondary market. So the deals are out there on Shirogorov, which helps offset some of those other issues that I mentioned as being more on the negative side. You know, final thoughts. I do think this is a fantastic knife. I'm really impressed with it. I like it a lot more than I thought that I would. The pocket clip, I don't have any issues with the pocket clip. Some do. But, you know, when I carry this knife, more often than not, it's going to just be carried inside the pocket. So the pocket clip functionality isn't that big of an issue for me. You know, again, there's some minor issues that, you know, at the size, it's a little bit, you got to make sure that you are very deliberate to place your fingers in a manner that you're not putting pressure on the lock bar if you want the best, smoothest deployment for this knife. So I'm getting better at that. But I did want to see what the fuss was about with Shirogorov. I can understand it now. I might even want to check out one of the larger versions. And that kind of does bring me to one of my other issues that's kind of kept me from buying a Shirogorov in the past. 3.5 inch blade length is kind of my baby bear soup, and it's a pretty standard blade length here in the United States. Many, many manufacturers, even outside the United States, you know, provide offerings at that 3.5 inch blade length. It seems like every Shirogorov that I've ever seen is either less, just under 3.5 inches, this 3.37 inch size, or they're like a 3.75, a little bit bigger than that, just big enough to be, you know, not as appealing as I would like. And I don't know why they don't have any offerings in that 3.5 inch sweet spot. Is this a metric issue? Because you know, the differences between our you know, the U.S. system of measurement and the metric system, why there's nothing that exists at that 3.5 inch blade length, I don't know. But I sure wish Shirogorov would make knives, you know, in that what I call baby bear soup for EDC. Based on my overall positive experience with this knife, I might want to get the version of this knife that is a little bit bigger, which I believe is the Hati. I still haven't wrapped my head around the different variations of Shirogorov knives, you know, there seems to be just when I think I've got a handle on what the naming conventions and what it means in terms of whether it's going to be all titanium or you know, all carbon fiber on both sides or a carbon fiber presentation scale. I see examples within those different models that seem to break the naming convention. So I think what I want is a Hati, that like a Hati R perhaps even, that is that 3.75 inch length. I think I would like to try something a little bit bigger than this one. Overall, I like it. I think I can conditionally recommend it with the caveats that I've mentioned. So there you have it. There's my review of the Shirogorov Hation Zero. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Take care. God bless. We'll see you in the next one. I hope you've enjoyed this production from the Through My Lens YouTube channel. If you did, please click on the like button and do share the video on social media. If you'd like to see more content like it, please do subscribe to the channel, follow me on Instagram and Facebook, and do check out Through My Lens at www.throughmylens.org.